Good afternoon. It's wonderful to see so many familiar faces in the audience. Hi to you all. It's great to see so many new faces here as well. Welcome. My name is Matt Scherer. I'm the director of George Mason's undergraduate program in Philosophy, Politics, and Economics, or PPE, as we call it. It's my pleasure to welcome you on behalf of the PPE program to today's inaugural Roger Wilkins lecture. As the director of the PPE program, I spend a lot of time explaining to audiences what PPE is and why it's valuable for students. I usually explain that we designed the program to attract our most curious and brightest students and help them develop the skills they need to tackle today's most complex, multifaceted, and difficult social problems. I also note that it's a rigorous academic program, but that it aspires to prepare students to have an impact beyond the academy. As a springboard to careers in civil service, journalism, business, or the law. But today my job in telling you about PPE is much easier than usual. Today, instead of going into details about our program, I have two examples to lean on. And those are Roger Wilkins, to whom this lecture series is dedicated, and James Forman Jr., who's joining us today as the series' inaugural speaker. I would be hard-pressed to find better examples for our students of individuals committed to applying their profound intelligence and their diverse skills and talents to grappling with some of American society's most difficult and pressing problems, and doing so with both intellectual rigor and practical determination. The PPE program is honored to be the institutional sponsor and host of the Roger Wilkins Lectures, and of today's speaker, Professor James Forman Jr. In short, if you want an easy answer to what we're trying to do with the PPE program, we're trying to teach our students to be more like these guys. Before I turn the microphone over to the next speaker, I want to handle two practical matters. The first is that you can find out more about the PPE program at our website, which is ppe.gmu.edu. And the second is, at the end of this event, after the question and answer, Professor Forman has graciously agreed to stay and meet with members of the audience. He'll have a book table where you can also pick up a copy of Locking Up Our Own. So without further ado, it's my pleasure to introduce the president of George Mason University, Dr. Angel Cabrera.
Thank you so much. This is very, very exciting. This is a true act of love by Roger's colleagues and dear friends. They very quickly, after we celebrated the recognition of the now Wilkins Plaza, the most central spot on campus, is named after Roger, and the faculty who spent time with him said, we need to have a lecture in his honor and memory. And this is, not to put any pressure on our speaker, this is number one, don't screw it up. I actually could not think of a better topic, a better subject, and a better individual to deliver this lecture. When we dedicated Wilkins Plaza, I spent quite a bit of time reading about Roger and reading Roger. And I was profoundly inspired by it. And I took some notes, and I'm going to use some of the notes that I took at the time, but they keep being incredibly relevant in today. And I think the lecture later is going to illustrate this very, very nicely. Now, many of our students who study history read and learn about the Civil Rights Act of 64 and the Voting Rights Act that ensued the next year. What they may not know is that Roger Wilkins was involved in those landmark pieces of legislation. He was a champion of the civil rights movement, and he served Presidents John F. Kennedy and Lyndon Johnson at that absolutely critical time in the history of this country. Later on, he was among the first black editorial writers at the Washington Post and the New York Times, and the editorials that he wrote in the context of the Watergate scandal earned him a share in the Pulitzer Prize that was awarded to the team for that work. Mason was incredibly fortunate to land him here at a time where Mason was not very well known, and he's one of the first big intellectuals that absolutely literally put this university on the map, and for that we would be eternally grateful, more so for the impact that he had in his students and the impact that he had in all the colleagues that got to work with him and call him a friend. Among the many things I read that he wrote and really that have changed the way I perceive even many current events, I'll just highlight a few. He spent quite a bit of time exploring the profound contradictions in the founding of the American Republic, and the meaning that those contradictions have for African Americans. He asked in many of his writings, how could it be that the individuals who established the principles of equality and personal liberty that are the foundation of our political system, including, by the way, the namesake of our very university where he taught, that these individuals also owned and exploited hundreds of men, women, and children during their lifetimes? How come the very people who didn't hesitate to fight the mightiest empire of their time in the name of natural, inalienable human rights, and they were at the same time unable or unwilling to share the gift of freedom with the people they enslaved and who afforded them their own wealth and pursuit of happiness? How are today's African Americans, he asked, to interpret that national founding narrative, to develop the sense of patriotic allegiance that is expected of them? As still very current events illustrate, these questions continue to be painfully relevant. He wrote in the introduction of one of his books, Jefferson's Pillow, that however noble their accomplishments, Jefferson and his fellow Virginians, George Washington, George Mason, James Madison, celebrated freedom while stealing the substance of life from the people they owned. Yet they also created the country that gives me, Roger, the descendant of slaves and slave owners, much of the context for my existence, the freedom that I cherish, and the democratic citizenship that I have used relentlessly for the past half century. He spoke at Columbia University in 1990, very special event. It was the celebration of the 200th anniversary of the Bill of Rights. And that day he spoke at length about the First Amendment in a room in the Columbia Library called the World Room. And he wrote that he had felt his Americanness more deeply than he ever had before. And in that lecture, he wondered what his 18th century Virginia ancestors would have thought if they had seen him in that very room speak about individual rights or preside, as he had a few years before, over the deliberations of the Pulitzer Prize Board. He wondered what the founders might have thought if they could see that the freedoms they fought for were not only still being celebrated, but had been at least partially afforded to people of all races and background. One would hope, he wrote, that after getting over their initial shock, they would be deeply pleased. The public place that now is named after Roger Wilkins is where the George Mason statue was erected. If anyone would have gotten a kick out of this historic collision in one space of these two names, Mason and Wilkins, Wilkins and Mason, these two distant points on that ever-bending arc of history, that would have been Roger himself. I can only wonder what Roger and George, I picture them walking down Wilkins Plaza, contemplating Mason's statue, having a nice conversation. I am pretty sure that after getting over their initial shock, as he said, they would be deeply pleased. It is a true honor to welcome all of you to the first inaugural Roger Wilkins Lecture. Thank you very much. And now, before I yield, it is my pleasure to to introduce to you. First of all, welcome to the entire family, Patricia, Elizabeth, Amy. I mean, it is terrific that you're with us today. It is my honor to introduce Roger's daughter, Amy Wilkins, who will tell us a little bit more about our guest lecturer. Amy Wilkins is Senior Vice President of Advocacy at the National Alliance for Public Charter Schools, continuing a distinguished career of advocacy for children that has included service at the Children's Defense Fund, the U.S. Department of Labor, the Education Trust, and many other organizations. Please give a warm welcome to Amy Wilkins.
Thank you. Hi. Look at you all. You look fabulous. This is so great. First, on behalf of Elizabeth, Graham, Tyler, Patricia, and Jackson, who's not here, thank you all for doing this for my dad. Looking at you, I can't imagine much that would delight him more than seeing your diversity, your curiosity, your willingness to come in here, James. This is the kind of thing that would just lift him and light him up, and even maybe enough to take some of the sting out of the Red Sox winning the series 2-0 right now. He was not a Red Sox fan, but I am. More than that, Dad would have recognized how important a gathering like this is right now. How important it is that at a time when hate is made visible and violent in this country, that there is reasonable conversation and inquiry, that there is an opportunity for people in calm voices to explore problems and try and move forward. I think that yesterday's events kind of moved me deeply in two real ways. I think Dad would have been particularly offended and horrified at the bomb that was sent to CNN. It was an attack on the First Amendment that Dad held sacred. But at the same time, Dad would have been quick to snap at those people who have been commenting nonstop on CNN how this is the biggest terrorist event in the history of our country. I think Dad would have reminded them that African Americans have been living with terror, often state-sponsored and state-sanctioned terror since we got here. And I miss him. I miss him in moments like this because he would have known what to say and he would have known how to deal with a country that is headed in the direction we are. But we still have wonderful people around. We have James. I am not going to tell you all of the fancy things James has done. You guys who are associated with this fine institution of higher learning can probably all read, and his bio is in your program. I want to tell you about how I know James, which isn't in your bio. When I worked at the Education Trust, I recruited James to be on our board of directors. And I think I ate in the dirtiest Chinese restaurant in Washington, D.C. that he picked. But because I wanted this man on my board, I ate some really nasty Chinese food. After James finally agreed to be on the board, how do I say this? I often regretted bringing him to the board. James was not the pushover board member that you could just walk into and give the okie doke to. James pushed me hard. He made me be better. He made me think harder. And as a result of my work with James, I think, as a member of the board of the Education Trust, I became more useful to the poor kids, the kids of color, that the Education Trust and James and I seek to serve. And I think in that way, it's really fitting that James does the inaugural lecture for this series, in that that's what Dad wanted from all of us. Dad pushed us to be smarter, to be better, to work harder on behalf of the people who this country has treated just awfully. And James does it beautifully. So thank you, James, for doing this, and come up.
Wow, okay, so they did not tell me that Amy was going to be doing an introduction, and if they had, I would have done a better job of emotionally preparing myself for the idea of being introduced by somebody who I have viewed for so many years as a courageous and fearless and passionate advocate for children, somebody who will take risks and somebody who... Let's see, I've got this lapel mic, so I think we're gonna get rid of this one. All right, that's off now, so hopefully it'll be okay. So thank you. Thank you. I want to thank the entire Wilkins family, in particular for me, Professor King, Pat King, who is one of the professors who welcomed me to the academy when I became a professor at Georgetown Law School. She was there. She had years of experience. She showed me the ropes. She taught me how to do the job. And whenever I had a problem with politics, a problem with personalities, a problem with teaching, I would go in Pat's door and her in her office, and she would close the door and she would set me straight, tell me everything I needed to know, tell me all the unofficial rules that that were not in the faculty handbook and are more important than the ones that are in the faculty handbook. And so thank you. Thank you for your lifetime of advocacy and your personal friendship. And Elizabeth is the other family member that I am closest to. When I, I said I wasn't gonna do this, but I am gonna say that I met Elizabeth when I arrived at Yale Law School. And she was there, she was in her third year. And she, in a sense, did for me at Yale what her mom had done for me at Georgetown, which was she told me really how the place worked. And she told me the kinds of professor that university needed right now. And I can't say that I've lived up to the standard that you set and the request that you made, but I can say that I have tried and I continue to try. Elizabeth is also doing amazing work right now just in Washington, D.C. on many of the topics that I'm going to be talking about today, topics of race and justice and punishment. There are books that are for sale, and the one thing that I want to say about that up front is, and I'm going to be signing, and when I was in school, I was on heavy, heavy financial aid. I don't know how things are now, but when I was a student, financial aid was great. I wouldn't have made it through college or law school without it, but it only covered the essentials and then just barely. And so when I was a student, I never had money for things like the notion of buying a book when an author came to speak at the university. So when I wrote this book, one of the things that I said to myself is that when I went to university campuses and I went to community centers, I was going to make a commitment that anybody who wanted to get the book should not have the price of the book be an obstacle. And so I want to tell you all that when you come up, and the bookseller is aware of this, you pay what you can for the book, and if what you can pay is a smile and a handshake, then that's what you pay, and you'll get a nice signature from me regardless. I also may run out of time. There may be conversations that you want to have that we're not able to have before the evening ends. And I would tell you that my website, jamesformanjr.com, you can connect with me that way. I have other speaking, but also I have email contact and other social media contact. So please take me up on that and let's keep this conversation going. I want to start by talking about my motivation for writing this book and beginning this exploration. And my motivation is one that Roger Wilkins would have understood well, and he articulated well. Because in his book, Jefferson's Pillow, he talked about the frustration that he had with African-American perspectives being left out of history, being left out of media. He talked about this from multiple standpoints, including he writes about watching a film where the film depicts Washington's crossing of the Delaware on Christmas night, 1776. And here's what Professor Wilkins says about that scene. He says, there are no black civilians, no black soldiers, no black slaves or body servants, just white people bravely and busily creating a country. And he knew that wasn't the truth about how the country was created, and he knew that you couldn't write history and leave African-American voices out of the narrative. And I agree. And so one of the things that I knew that I wanted to do when I sat down to write a book is I wanted to write a book that was rooted in black voices, in the black perspectives, that presented African-American politicians, elected officials, judges, prosecutors, police officers, legislators, corrections officers, activists, public defenders, struggling over the last 50 years with what to do about this problem of crime and violence. And my other motivation for writing the book came out of my work in the criminal legal system. You know, I'm still torn. You'll hear me in this talk. When I was writing the book, and the references in the book talk about the criminal justice system. And more I've come, like a lot of people, to start referring to it as the criminal legal system, because it seems to me often that it doesn't deserve to have the word justice in the title. Not yet. So you'll hear me use both, but this experience that I'm going to describe, and there are a lot of stories in the book. There's history and there's argument. There's even a tiny bit of law. I don't know that there's a case cited, but there's a little bit of law. But really, it's all wrapped in a set of stories. And one of the stories is of a young man I represented by the name of Brandon. Brandon was a teenage client of mine, 15 years old, Superior Court, Washington, D.C., and he had been charged with and pled guilty to possession of a gun and a small amount of marijuana, $15, $20 worth. And now he's facing sentencing. And I was his public defender. I had been appointed to represent him in this case. And I had taken the job of being a public defender because I viewed it as the civil rights work of my generation. My parents met in SNCC, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, one of the major civil rights organizations of the 1960s, and it was in many ways the most aggressive. It was the one, as the name suggests, the one that had young people, the one that was led by students. My dad is African American, my mom is white. So they're an interracial couple in the 1960s at a time when those marriages are illegal in many states in this country. And their generation and their fight and their struggle changed and transformed America in ways that we yet haven't still taken account of. I mean, theirs was the generation that faced down Bull Connor's dogs in Birmingham, that marched across the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma, that went to D.C. 250,000 strong for the March on Washington for jobs and freedom. I mean, theirs was the generation, and I should say, when I say theirs, I know there's some people in the room that when I say theirs, for you, I'm not going to call you out, but I'm talking about yours and your generation. So if that's you, when you hear me say theirs, for you, I'm saying yours. Their generation, right? They passed the Civil Rights Act of 1964, the Voting Rights Act of 1965, the Fair Housing Act of 1968. I mean, in school, they'll teach you that Congress passed those laws and the president signed them, and that's true. But don't kid yourself. The only reason those laws got passed were because people marched and people fought and people got active and people voted. So that generation made it possible for me to have a life that was not imaginable to my parents' generation, to my father's generation. And yet and still, even with all that success, as I was graduating from law school and deciding what I was going to do with my career, I saw that there was unfinished business to the civil rights movement.
And I'm not saying that this is the only place where the unfinished business was, but the place that I saw it was in our criminal legal system. We didn't have the term mass incarceration. When I graduated in law school, that's a term that was created in the year 2000. I graduated in the mid-90s, year 2000, to describe this phenomenon. But we didn't have the term, but we already knew that 1 in 3 young black men was under criminal justice supervision. We already knew from that same report of the Sentencing Project that black women were the largest single growing portion of our prison population. We already knew that the United States had passed Russia and South Africa to earn the dishonor of being the world's largest jailer. We already knew that we had 5% of the world's population and 25% of its prisoners. And I had seen some of the changes and transformations in American society that created those numbers. I had seen them happen in my own lifetime. As a child growing up in Atlanta, I grew up in a mostly African-American kind of working class, borderline in pockets, middle class neighborhood. And I could see already policing practices and how they broke down along racial lines. I'm African-American, but I'm so light that the police sometimes didn't know it. And there was a difference in the way that I was policed when I was by myself in the neighborhood versus when I was with my friends. 2 blocks from my house, in either direction as a child, were 2 huge institutions. If you went one way, you got to a General Motors plant. If you went the other way, you got to the Atlanta Federal Penitentiary. That's when I was a kid. Fast forward to graduating from law school. At that point, one of those buildings had shut down, doors padlocked, jobs shipped overseas. And the other building had built an addition, an extra wing. I don't think I need to tell y'all which is which. So, wanting to fight this struggle brought me to be a public defender. It brought me to be standing next to Brandon asking for probation. I had a letter from a teacher and a counselor at his school. His mother and grandmother were there in court. They were sitting in the front row of the courtroom. They wanted him to come home. The prosecutor in the case, she wanted him to go to Oak Hill. Now, Oak Hill is like a lot of juvenile facilities, or was, in this country. It combines a very nice-sounding name, like an oak tree on a hill, with a brutal, brutal reality. It was a place where drugs and violence were rampant. It was a place where there were no programs. I mean, if you went down to the mayor's office, they would give you a list, but it wasn't true. If you went out there, they weren't happening. It was a place where, as a young person, you always left worse off than when you entered. The judge had to make the decision in the case, Judge Curtis Walker, and I should say that's not his real name. I changed the name of everybody in the cases to protect the identity of my clients. He's not a real name, but he's a real judge. He's an African-American judge. That's not unusual. 40% of the Superior Court bench at the time is African-American in D.C. And so he looks out in this courtroom, he sees a young man facing sentencing, African-American defense lawyer, black prosecutor, and now he's getting ready to pass sentence. And he looks at Brandon, and he looks at him dead in the eye and looks at him hard. And he says, son, Mr. Forman's been telling me that you've had a tough life, that you deserve a second chance. Well, son, let me tell you about tough. Let me tell you about Jim Crow segregation. The judge had been a child in those years, so he proceeds to lecture Brandon on what it was like. And then he says, so here's the thing, son. People fought, people marched, people died for your freedom. Dr. King died for you. And I tell you this, he didn't die for you to be running and gunning and thugging and carrying on, embarrassing your family, embarrassing your community, carrying that gun. So I hope Mr. Forman is right. I hope one day you turn it around. But today, in this courtroom, actions have consequences. And your consequence is Oak Hill. He locked him up. And I was so angry, so frustrated that day, I mean, think about it. The judge had taken the same history, invoked the same hero. My dad walked with Dr. King. He had invoked the same history that I told you motivated me to become a public defender. And he had somehow taken that movement and its struggles and its victories and twisted it on its head in this perverse rationale for a moral justification for locking up Brandon. But over time, I began to work through my anger. Still in process on that. And as I did, I began to think about the fact that, you know, the judge was not alone. I mean, I told you that 40% of the judges in Superior Court are African American. But the city council that passed the gun and the drug laws in DC was a majority black city council. The police force was a majority black. The police chief was black. The mayor was black. The chief prosecutor in the city, y'all, was none other than Eric Holder. Before he became known to the nation, he was the chief prosecutor in Washington, D.C. And so I had to ask the question, right? What happened in this country over the last 50 years? What was so powerful? What was so all-encompassing? What happened that even in a majority black jurisdiction where we had some measure of control over local criminal justice policies, how was it that we were making some of the same policy choices, passing some of the same laws, doing some of the same things that the rest of the country was doing? How could that be? I mean, I told y'all that 1 in 3 young black men was under criminal justice supervision nationally. In DC, it was 1 in 2. So that's the question of the book. And we could stop now, and everybody could go get a copy. Y'all could get the answer. I don't know if they're doing this, Amy. I don't know if they're still doing this, or, you know, how common this is in schools. But in my son's school, they do sustained silent reading. I don't know if y'all did this when y'all were in school, but it's great. The teachers have, it is so slick. They have a competition for how long the kids can read without talking. So he comes home, and he's like, Dad, we made it to 26 minutes of sustained silent reading. And the kids don't realize, I don't think they realize that, like, if collectively they all talk at like second 30, they could have early recess. But I'm thinking y'all don't want to do the sustained silent reading right now. You probably have enough reading. So let me just give you the kind of the main points of the argument. The first thing is this: rising crime and violence and addiction and the fear and the anger that those generated in black communities over the last 50 years. Especially in the crack years of the 80s and 90s, and then the heroin years of the 1960s. And most people know something about the crack years, so let me say something about the 1960s. Because in the 1960s in this country, right before this first generation of black elected officials would come into office, the homicide rate in this country doubled. In DC, it tripled. In New York, it more than doubled. Heroin. They test everyone entering the DC jail every year for substances. In 1964, they found that 4% of the people entering the jail were heroin addicts. By 1969, the 4% had become 45%. Now, that's an epidemic. And it wasn't just the numbers, but it was also the response that they generated in the community. So to write this book, I was lucky. A lot of elected officials in DC turn their papers over to local archives. And the great thing for me was they were not just the statements of the government officials, but the letters that they had received from citizens. Now, they're not scanned. There's no keyword searches. Your computer, your laptop is not going to help you here. It's just pieces of paper in manila files. You have to look through one after the other. But if you do it for a bunch of summers, you get this amazing social history. Because this is a mostly black city. In the 1970s, DC is 70% black. Chocolate City. So these are mostly black citizens writing to mostly black elected officials. The DC Council, the first home rule DC Council, 11 out of 13 members was African American. And what do these letters reveal? A pain and an anger. People say, we just fought the civil rights movement, and I'm afraid to take my kid to school. They're selling drugs on the corner. They're shooting in the park. They say, I feel like a stranger on my own city streets. I feel like a prisoner in my own home. And the letters all end with some version of do something, you gotta do something about it. Now, who's receiving these letters? That's the second big argument in the book. Because the generation of people who is receiving these letters is the first generation of black elected officials to be elected in any number in this country since Reconstruction. In the 1970s and 1980s, there was an 800% increase in African-American elected officials nationwide. Now, that's an 800% increase over almost zero, but it's an 800% increase. And it's because of the Voting Rights Act of 1965, principally. So this is a generation of officials. Many of them are from the South. Many of them were in the civil, some of them were in the civil rights movement. All of them remember the long history of under-enforcement and under-protection of the law that has been part of the black experience in this country since slavery. So they remember. They remember Southern sheriffs in cahoots with the Klan asked about a homicide in a black neighborhood under Jim Crow. They said, that's not a homicide. That's another dead black person. And y'all, they didn't use the words black person. I mean, they remember, my dad used to tell me about this. He grew up in Jim Crow, Mississippi, Jim Crow, south side of Chicago. He used to talk about how, he said, we didn't call the police in a black neighborhood when there was a crime. The police weren't gonna come. They didn't care about black victims. And if they came, the only thing you could be sure of is they were gonna make matters worse. So they remember this history. And now they're in office, and they have some measure of control of local government police departments. And with that control, the power that they have, they are bound and determined to make that government and those law enforcement officials responsible to those citizens who are writing, who are asking for protection. Those citizens wouldn't have bothered to write under Jim Crow. They would have known that the elected officials weren't going to listen. Now there's black elected officials in office. They have a hope and an expectation that they're going to get a response. And at least some of them, the elected officials, want to respond. Okay. So crime is rising, and addiction is rising, and people are scared. They're asking for protection, and there's a generation of elected officials that wants to provide it. But how come the answer is police and prosecutors? Why is that the response? And here's where I told you all before that this is a book about black voices, black activists, black legislators, black citizens. But any book, right? Any book that's about the African-American perspective, when we're a minority, is also always going to be a book about the larger society and the way in which those individuals that I'm writing about were constrained and limited in what they could do in response. So I want to talk about what some of the constraints and limitations were on this generation of black elected officials. The first constraint is a historical one. This is a generation of people who has been elected to represent neighborhoods that, because of a history of slavery, which we had in this country for longer than we have not, please never forget that. They teach it like it's a unit. It's like a little piece. It's most of American history. And I'm just talking about straight up slavery, please. I'm not talking about metaphorical. I mean straight up, 1619 to 1865 is more years than 1865 to the present. Now, bring in Jim Crow. If you add that on, entrenched white supremacy, again, not metaphorical, in law, white people rule, has been 85% of American history. Because of that history and then all the policy choices that grow out of it, right? Policy choices like redlining, like wealth discrimination, like usurious lenders going into black communities and ripping out the wealth from those communities. Decisions about where to build the federal highways. We built a national highway system in the 1950s and 1960s that most of us take for granted today. I know I do. Well, those highways had to be put somewhere. And in city after city, they were put through the neighborhoods with the least political power. They were put through black neighborhoods. I don't know where folks are from, but let me just tell you about Atlanta. Who's driven through Atlanta? Okay. If you've driven through Atlanta, you've driven on I-75 or I-85, most probably. We're crazy down there, so it's like 12 lanes. Every time I go home, it's another lane. like 12 lanes in each direction. You don't know it, but you're driving through what was called the Black Wall Street. Auburn Avenue, Dr. King was raised by this neighborhood, and it was destroyed by the federal highways. So because of a series of policy decisions, the neighborhoods that this first generation of Black elected officials have been elected to represent have been deprived the wealth and the other resources that they need to protect themselves. So they're over-reliant on the government. They're over-reliant on the state, on police and prosecutors for protection. And remember, police and prosecutors are no neighborhood, no community's first line of protection. That's who you turn to when you can't protect yourself otherwise, when you don't have the resources to protect yourself otherwise. And if you don't believe me, just think for a minute about a safe neighborhood that you envision in your head. The one thing I will tell you about did not come to your mind was a police car. That's one constraint, history. Politics is another constraint. The argument in my book is that local politics matters, right, for how we got mass incarceration and how we're going to have to respond. But there are limits to local politics. One of those limits, right, you can see over and over again in the story, which is that for the last 50 years, Black elected officials have had what I call an all of the above strategy to fighting crime and violence. They've said we want more police and more prosecutors. But they've also said we want more housing, and we want more jobs, and we want more education, and we want more health care, and we want more mental health treatment. We want more drug treatment. We're passing local gun control laws wherever we can, but we want national gun control because we know local gun control by itself won't make the difference. Black elected officials have been saying for 50 years, we want a Marshall Plan for urban America. We want the United States government to do for Black communities what it did for Europe after World War II. Reinvest, rebuild, revitalize. For 50 years, they've been going to Congress with this all of the above strategy. And for 50 years, they've been coming back with money for one of the above. And what's that? Law enforcement, police, and prosecutors, and prisons. Last constraint, and I'll say this one last, because it's a constraint that I think we still suffer from. I'm going to suffer from all of these, but this is a constraint that we still suffer from, and that the generation of people who's in this room, the generation of people, students today, is in the best position to liberate yourselves from and thereby liberate the country from. And this is a constraint of imagination. This is a generation of people who were constrained by their imaginations and how to respond to what were real and pressing and genuine social problems. So again, there's a lot of examples of it, but let me give you one. One of the people that I write about in the book is a guy named David Clark. Now, if you've been around for DC for a while, you smile when you hear the name David Clark. I told y'all that 11 out of 13 members of that first city council were African American. David Clark was one of the two white members. He had an unusual bio. He went to Howard Law School in the 1960s. He graduated from Howard, worked for Martin Luther King, then he becomes a lawyer for poor people, and then he runs for city council. Now, Dave, for the purposes of tonight, what you need to know about David Clark is that he was not a drug warrior. The first thing that he did when he went into office was he pushed for marijuana decriminalization in 1975. He lost, but he fought for it. He fought the good fight. Now, fast forward 1980s, heroin has come back in the city. I told you it was devastating in the 1960s, and it kind of steps back a little in the 70s, but in the 80s, overdose deaths are rising, letters to the editor are increasing, and those letters to city council members that I mentioned to you are increasing in velocity and ferocity. David Clark's now the chair of the city council, and he's getting all these letters. And these letters now are about heroin addicts, overwhelmingly. Heroin addicts gathering in public space, heroin addicts on the stoops. I don't endorse this language, but it's the language of the letters. Junkies gathering in the park and sleeping on park benches. Dirty syringes everywhere. Now, David Clark gets all these letters, and responsible elected official, he sends them to the head of the relevant government agency. He gets a letter back each time. Councilmember Clark, I've received your letter, your citizen complaint. We're on the case. Now, who does David Clark send the letters to? Remember, the problem, stated problem in the letter is heroin addicts in public space. Who does he send? Who does this non-drug warrior, marijuana decriminalizer, send them to? Does he send them to the head of the Department of Mental Health, Public Health, Addiction Services, Treatment? No. He's not a drug warrior, but he's an American. And like so many of us, he's constrained by his imagination, so he sends them to the police chief. Because he can't imagine the problem of heroin addicts as, in public space as being a public health problem, a social services problem. It's a police problem. It's a problem that we respond to with somebody whose only tools are handcuffs and gun, and only place that they can take you for treatment where there is no treatment is the local jail. And the argument of my book is that to understand how we got mass incarceration, it's important to look at speeches of presidents and acts of Congress. But it's just as important, it's crucially important, that we look at tiny, small decisions made across 50 states, across 3,000 counties that make up America, across 50 years. Tiny decisions, some of them made by well-intentioned, well-meaning people, not all of them, but some of them. Like the decision, which government agency do I call for help? Do I enlist when I'm presented with a problem of a heroin addict in public space? And that it's those tiny decisions that are the individual bricks that collectively, together, make up the prison nation that America has become. Now, one thing that Roger Wilkins would not stand for, would cause him to figure out a way to contact the president right now and say, you made a mistake. Forman cannot give the inaugural lecture. Stop right now. One thing he would not stand for is any kind of talk that talked about a problem and stopped there and didn't have some conversation about what we were going to do about it. Right? He would not have stood for that. And I hated when I was in school. It still happens. But I noticed it most when I was a student. You go to these, and I was always going to the social justice lectures. People would come, they would give a lecture, they would describe a problem in compelling and gruesome detail. It was their life's work, moral urgency. And then as soon as they finished, they were like, close their book, and they're like, okay, thank you, and leave us all totally depressed. So Roger wouldn't want it, and so I'm not going to do it. So let me spend a few words just talking about some things, the last little portion here, talking about some things about how we can think about how to respond to this problem. And the first thing that I'm going to say is not a particular policy idea, but it is a way of thinking about the problem. And it comes from a conversation that I had with my mother many years ago. I was in high school. Now, I went to 10 schools for 12 grades. Amy Wilkins would tell you that there is a mountain of educational research that suggests this is not a good plan. And there are a lot of things. There are a lot, and you need Amy for a lot, but you're probably like, I don't even need her research for that, because that's common sense. There are a lot of things that are great about being a child of civil rights activists. One thing that is not so good is that you move a lot. And the school that you end up in is an often, like, I'm not even going to call it a secondary concern. It's like a fifth tier concern. So 10th grade, I'm in a new high school in Atlanta. And I'm in the bathroom, it's second to third day of school, I'm still figuring my way around the place, and I see a scene that is really, really bothers me. It was nothing physical, but it was bullying. And I didn't really have the words to explain exactly what was happening at the time, but now I know this kid was being bullied about kind of how he presented himself, his kind of a feminine presentation, and how he dressed, and these other kids were giving him a hard time. And I know what to do. I left. I talked to my mom when I got home. And my mom was She was a civil rights activist, so she was always up in the school about something. Prayer in school is unconstitutional, this, that, and the other thing. So I was like, Mom, you're always up in the school. This thing just happened to me. It's really terrible. I feel awful. And I had ideas for what the principal could do. I had ideas for what the dean of students could do to make the school safe. I had ideas for what my mom could do, how she could go up to the school and agitate. And my mom heard all this. And then she said, well, I appreciate that. She said, I just have one question for you. She said, what are you going to do? What are you going to do? And I've always tried to take that conversation with me. Because when you're looking at this a massive social problem that can feel so insurmountable, it's often easy to try to think about like what somebody else should do in response. And there are things that other people should do in response, but we also have to start with asking the question, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? So I'm going to just throw out a couple of different things that, and these ideas that I'm going to throw out are, they're really, I'm not even saying they're two or three most important things, but they're things that I hope kind of prompt your thinking. So I'm just going to say one that might seem a little offbeat, but let me say it. Jury service. Now, if y'all who are students, you're going to start to get notices to serve on juries. Now, if you're like most Americans, like 99% of Americans, the first thing you're going to do is throw it away, hope it didn't happen, hide it, put it in the recycling if you're environmentally friendly, and or reschedule it after you get second, you know, for as long in advance as you can. And then when you get there, if you're a critic of the criminal justice system, if you're the kind of person who comes to a lecture like this, if you're a kind of person who reads Professor Wilkins, the first thing you're going to do is you're going to try to figure out a way to get off the jury. You're going to be like, I can't be fair. I don't trust the police. I went to this mass incarceration lecture, and the system is terrible. Yeah, y'all are laughing because you know how people do. Don't do that. Don't do that. We need you on the jury. The right to serve on a jury was understood during Reconstruction and by the civil rights movement as being fundamental, foundational, right next to the right to vote. It was a different place to vote, the jury box. That means the grand jury, which is who decide, which is the group that decides whether a charge is going to be brought or not. And it also means the petit jury, the jury that actually sits and hears the trial. What I want to say to y'all is this. If you avoid jury service or you figure out a way to talk yourself off the jury, then the jury is going to be made up of people who are cool with our criminal justice system, who are like, yeah, 5% of the world's population, 23% of the world's prisoners, all right. And we're going to keep getting the results that we get. We're going to keep getting people not charged who should be charged. And we're going to also get people convicted or overconvicted who should be acquitted. So please, I mean, I like that thing only comes every couple years, but I'm like rushing to get that notice. Now, y'all have to be like me, but serve. Okay. I said it's related to the right to vote. It's another form of voting. And then there's a ballot box. Now, we are at a crucial time in American history in terms of elections. About 20% of people in their 20s, last midterm elections, voted. That's not okay. You would not trust older people, you don't trust older people to make decisions about your lives on small things. Please do not let older people make decisions on your lives about the future of the country. The good news is this, is that, and it's not just national elections, let me say, it's local elections. If you care about mass incarceration, understand this. Mass incarceration is overwhelmingly a state and local issue. 85% of prisoners in this country are in state and local prisons. Mandatory minimums, state law. Drug sentences, state law. Life without parole, state law. Felon disenfranchisement, state law. It's your state house and your state senator who matter. And some of the decisions are even more local than that. School to prison pipeline. You know who influences that most directly? The school board. And in the criminal legal system, you know who the most powerful actor is? Is the county prosecutor. The county prosecutor, small local office. Most people don't know who their county prosecutor is. For the last 50 years in this country, the only way you got elected local prosecutor is by saying, I'm gonna lock up more people for longer and make sure they're kept in worse conditions than my opponent. And in the last couple of years, that has started to change. In the November 2016 election, here's some good news. Stay with me. In Georgia, in Alabama, in Florida, in Texas, in Chicago, in Denver, in some very conservative jurisdictions, people ran for local prosecutor on campaigns of mass incarceration is a human rights issue, and we should decriminalize low-level drug offenses, and I'm going to stop asking for cash bail. And they not only ran, but they won. A guy in Texas, a career defense attorney, with the words not guilty tattooed on his chest. I am hardcore criminal defense to the end. There's no not guilty tattooed anywhere. This guy is not guilty tattooed on his chest. And he ran for county prosecutor in Texas against an incumbent, not an open seat, and won. In Philadelphia, some of y'all may have heard about Larry Krasner. He's gotten the most attention of this new generation of prosecutors. Larry Krasner, there's a piece out on this week's New Yorker. One of the things that Larry Krasner is doing that's so revolutionary is he's told all of the prosecutors in his office that when you ask for prison time, a prison sentence in Pennsylvania costs $42,000 a year. So if you're going to ask for prison time, you have to put on the record how many years times $42,000 that this is going to cost, and here's why it's justified. And the reason why that is so revolutionary is that prison is the one thing that has never had to justify itself ever in our criminal system. It's just the default. Programs have to justify themselves. Cost-benefit analysis, effectiveness study, can it be replicated, scaled up? Prisons never have to defend themselves. Nobody says, prison didn't work last time, so maybe we shouldn't try it this time. Nobody says, well, we don't have bed space, so we can't put them in prison. That's what they say about programs. So what Krasner is doing, he's starting to subject prisons to the same test of efficacy that the rest of the system has always been subjected to, and it's not going to hold up. Once you start to ask the question, because once you start to put $42,000 times five on the table for a five-year sentence, then the next question is, what else could we do with that $200,000? But to get people like Larry Krasner in office, and to keep people like Carl Racine, the Attorney General in Washington, D.C., who is part of this breed, not as well known as in terms of the movement, because a lot of people don't think about D.C. in the same way, although they should. But he's part of this movement. So to get people in office and keep them in office is going to require y'all to vote. Now, if I haven't said enough to persuade you about voting, let me just tell you something that Roger Wilkins told me. In 2008, I had the great, great honor of my life, and I have pictures that I will always cherish from these days of campaigning in Virginia, knocking on doors, door to door, asking people for their vote for President Obama, for candidate Obama, with Roger Wilkins. And he actually, like, he did some houses. He and my wife went together for a little portion, and he was with my mother, but when we would reconvene, so I acted like I was standing right next to him, but I wasn't quite, but I heard his stories when they came back to the car. And one of the stories that he told, when he came back to the car, he had been canvassing with my wife or with my mom, I can't remember which one, he had been canvassing with them, and somebody had answered the door. Young dude, mid-20s, African-American dude, and he had said, he was like, yeah, I don't know if I'm gonna vote, I don't really think my vote matters. And this, man, this was like, I'm thinking, this guy, of all the people, think about it, like, of all the people who are door knocking, this dude says this to Roger Wilkins, who fought for the Voting Rights Act. So Roger Wilkins says, he says, listen, if your vote didn't matter, and then he starts talking about my dad. He says, if your vote didn't matter, then James Forman and SNCC and John Lewis at the Edmund Pettus Bridge would not have gotten their heads beat open to win this right. And also, because he knew that maybe the history lesson was going to, I don't know, be lost on the dude. But so then he said, and if you don't believe, care about history, believe this. If your vote didn't matter, how come they're fighting so hard now to suppress it? Right? So, if the stories of how we can make a difference don't persuade you, then if for nobody else, vote, and not just vote yourself, but text somebody and tell them to vote, do it for Professor Wilkins. Last thing I'm gonna talk about in terms of ideas for how we can push back against mass incarceration has to do with education. I can't not talk about education at a university. I can't not talk about education when I'm giving a lecture honoring a consummate educator. There are a lot of things that we could say about education in this space. We could talk about the way in which education helps keep people out of the criminal justice system, but I'm just gonna say something about my role and the work that I do in education in prisons, because that's something that I've been doing for the last few years of my life, and I just wanna say something about it because it's not that well known of a topic. But I teach a class called Race, Class, and Punishment at Yale. Been teaching it for years. And I've been going and giving talks, and a couple years ago, I was talking about my mom and what can you do, and I told that story. And when I got back to my hotel room, I started to think about my mom's question, and I started to ask myself, was I doing everything that I could do? And I write and talk, and I try to participate in advocacy movements, but so much of what I do fundamentally is teach. You know, that's like the biggest part of my job, in a way. And I love teaching at Yale, but I'm teaching some of the most privileged students I'm teaching students that have had every resource poured into them for their entire life. And now I'm doing the same. And so I started thinking about, you know, Connecticut is full of these prisons. I mean, every state is. We've cut back on prison education dramatically. How could I get inside the prisons to teach? And I got trained in a program called Inside Out. Inside Out is a national program. It exists in 30 states. What it does is it trains professors to teach what you teach at your home university inside a local prison or jail. And what's different about it is that the classroom is made up of 10 students from your university and 10 students who are incarcerated. And they study together in a seminar setting the same material or similar material to what you would have studied if you had taught the class in the law school. For me, it's the most meaningful teaching that I do. I always tell my colleagues, don't do this for self-interested reasons, but professors in the room, the best teaching evaluations that I get in any class are in my Inside Out class. So if you need a little bump up, you know, on your evaluations. But the most meaningful ones come from my students, the incarcerated students in particular. I mean, I see the way it transforms the law students, because one of the ways in which we sustain mass incarceration is by completely distancing everybody from the reality of what is happening in prison, so it remains an abstract. And as long as it's an abstract, we just think of they, them, other, criminal, dangerous, and we just avert our eyes. But when you go inside, when you are there, you realize the humanity, and then you realize the injustice of what we are doing. One of the young men who was incarcerated at the end of the, I teach in the men's prison in the fall and a women's prison in the spring, and he said at the end of the semester, last time I taught, he said, I like the law and the policy that we learn in this class, but what I liked most of all was I liked that when I entered the seminar, I entered a space where my ideas mattered, where people thought I was smart. I entered a space where I was treated like, and on some days I even felt like, an intellectual. Here's the last thing I want to share with you. I told you a conversation with my mom. Let me say something about a conversation that I had with my dad. It was a couple years before he passed, we watched a movie about the civil rights movement. And when the movie was over, I asked him, what'd you think? You were there? He said, well, I liked that they presented this history in film, because more people watch movies than read books, which is something that I probably should have thought about before. But he said, what I didn't like about it is that they made it seem like everybody was in the movement. And that's not true. We were just a few people. We were outsiders. We were unpopular. And he said, I'm not saying this because I want to claim credit for myself. He said, I'm saying this because I don't like those representations, because what they do is they demoralize future generations. And I'm talking now especially to anybody who's an activist, anybody who's an advocate, anybody who does work in this space, who calls meetings on a topic, and six people show up, and they're the same six people who were at the last meeting, and you're wondering, and then you go see these movies about the movement, and it's masses of people in the streets. And you're like, well, something must be wrong with my cause because I don't have all those people. Well, Dr. King was unpopular when he died. 2/3 of Americans had an unfavorable view of him. The March on Washington was unpopular when it happened. 2/3 of Americans said it wasn't going to help the cause of the Negro. I mean, 250,000 people were at the March on Washington, and that's a lot. But a decade later, 10 million people were like, I was there. So this is the thing. This is my dad's point. He said, when you are facing a huge, impossible, insurmountable obstacle entrenched into law and baked into policy and attitudes, and you want to do something about it, and you want to fight it, and you don't want to have your imagination constrained by previous generations, people are going to tell you that change is impossible. And then it's even worse, because if you ignore them and you fight and you defeat it, the same people that told you change was impossible are going to turn around and say, oh, that was inevitable. I knew that was going to happen. No, you didn't. You said it was impossible. And then they're going to make a movie about it. So I don't know what the idea is in this room or the group of people that is in this room, but I know SNCC was started on a college campus. And I don't know what the idea is, but I know it's bigger and better and bolder than any idea that I've come up with. So I don't know the particulars and I don't know the who, but I know the ideas in the room and I know the people is in the room. And I know that when you ignore those who tell you that change is impossible, and you come together with a new idea and a new approach and a new strategy to take down mass incarceration and replace it with a system of justice that actually deserves to have the word justice attached to it, a system that repairs and restores communities. I know that when you do that, you will be honored. They will make a movie about you. And when they do, I'll be in the front row with Amy Wilkins, Ann Elizabeth, and Pat King, and their families, and Lori Robinson. We will be in the front row. Roger Wilkins will be looking down with pride. We will be in the front row eating popcorn and cheering your success. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Is looking down on all of us and looking down on you and absolutely smiling. So thank you for your wonderful presentation, your cogent remarks. And I'm sure all of us are full, right? We are inspired. And perhaps we also have some questions or remarks that we would like to offer. We have two mics on either side. So I'm not sure how much time we want to allot this evening. About 10 minutes, okay. So if you keep your remarks concise or questions, I think that might mean we can get in at least two or three. So would anyone like to come forward? We've got one, okay.
How you doing? Already? Oh, how you doing, man? First of all, I want to say I was locked up when I read your book. And yeah, it was intense. That was when Michelle Alexander was really popping and whatnot. People were kind of like letting yours fly under the radar. So I just picked one up. And yeah, they let me take it home too. I didn't bring it with me, so maybe I could get your signature to just stick in there. But
absolutely.
Yeah, that being said, I respect everything that you said. I respect everything you did. That being said, I hate to play devil's advocate. But now that you're here in person, I mean, I got to ask you this pressing question.
I want you to play devil's advocate.
All right, let's do it then.
This is a university.
Of course, let's have some fun. So, me as a young black male that's been incarcerated and is still on probation and still dealing with the troubles that you're talking about, I have to tell you that mid-25 guy that, you know, Wilkins locked on his door, I relate to that. I don't think that, and especially the majority of black movements that you see with starting with Malcolm X and sort of going in that, spiraling in that direction, we don't really see how trying to fix a system that has been oppressing us is going to help us. The majority of revolutionaries and activists that I see my age and my color aren't worried about the criminal legal system or anything. We're worried about creating our own system or fighting back through a revolution that isn't on paper. We don't see the paperwork helping us. So if you could give me, I don't see anything short of a physical battle, a physical revolution that's going to change any of the paperwork or the legal administrative racism that has been institutionalized in our system. So maybe you can change my mind on that. But as far as voting, as far as seeing what we call the white oppressive system changing, a lot of us don't see it happening.
Yeah, I hear that. And I understand. I think that there's a lot of reasons for you to be skeptical, right? There's a lot of reasons for all of us to be skeptical. But there are reasons for the people that have been most harmed by the system, who have seen the fewest opportunities, who, for whom that civil rights movement that I invoked have produced the least change or no change, or it feels like things could be even worse, that for you, for somebody who's in that position, I think that I understand why you would have that view. And I don't know, you know, I wasn't there at the door so I don't know exactly what was behind that man that he spoke to in terms of why he said. So You know, I guess I would say a couple things. One, you know, I'm not, when you say physical, at least for me anyway, I don't see violence for myself. I don't know what physical means necessarily. I don't know if it's a euphemism or if it means something
more like different. More in the same way in 1776 that America got their independence from England, kind of in that same way, if you understand
right.
what I'm saying. Yeah.
Right. So there, you know, I don't think the numbers support it, among other things. I also don't think, I don't think it's the right way to go. I can imagine historical circumstances where I would say that maybe it was the right way to go. Obviously, there are moments where there are violence and war that we now honor, whether it's that or it's World War II. So I respect that. But I guess the other thing that I would say is that I don't see that even if you believe what you believe, and it'll take longer than the 3 minutes we have tonight, right, for us to figure that out. But even if you believe that, it would seem to me that there's a lot of pain and suffering that can be ameliorated, that can be avoided by right now, by things like voting. And that doesn't stop you from pursuing your larger goals. So just to take Philadelphia, for example, a year ago, there were 5,000 people in the Philadelphia jail. That's when Larry Krasner got into office. He got into office, these exact conversations were happening in activist groups in Philadelphia, right? Because a lot of people made the argument that you made. Other people said, listen, he's not gonna be an abolitionist, and because he's going to be a prosecutor, so he's going to ask for somebody to be locked up. So I'm not going to knock on a door and ask you to vote for somebody who's going to ask for somebody to be locked up. That didn't end up being the majority view. Most of the activists said, well, it really, the particulars matter. And if this is like a lukewarm or kind of half-baked so-called reformer, then no, I'm not going to do it. But if it's somebody who has as aggressive as his career suggests that he will be, then for him, I'm going to take this chance. And in a year, there's 1,000 people, overwhelmingly black and brown and overwhelmingly poor, who were in jail a year ago, who are not in jail today. Their pain and their suffering has been ameliorated. Their families are closer to being made whole. And they are at least in a position to possibly get involved in the struggle for justice, whether it's on my terms or on your terms. And before then, they weren't. So I would argue that it's my stance is either the end goal, if you're with me, or it's a step along the way, or if you're with you, but either way, it's a step that should be taken.
I appreciate that, thank you.
Thank you. Yeah, come get a book, man.
I already got one, man.
No, but I'm saying get one signed.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Yeah. Appreciate you.
All right. You can get in the front. Tell them I said so.
Anyone else? Question? Yes, please. The mic is yours.
Hello. I'm not actually a student of George Mason, but I've had the fortunate privilege of knowing Roger Wilkins on a close to familial level, and his family, Elizabeth, and all of them. And because of that, I've been surrounded pretty much all my life with a host of very intellectual, honored African-American role models. And as a flip of that, there's always been a high standard of expectation and the mantra that you have to work twice as hard to get half as far in this world. Especially as an African-American man, or just as an African-American in general. And when you told that story of Brandon at the court and the judge somewhat, patronizing him with, making a judgment on his actions and his circumstances, what do you think needs to be held on to or kept in mind so that people can retain the compassion to have empathy and understanding for people in their circumstances, to give them that chance rather than just focusing on, you should be at this standard, and when you're not, we need to purge you, or we need to punish you, or we need to correct this, and we're going to be maybe twice as hard because we are from that same experience, or we are from that same community, and we want to give the image that it's going, that we're perfect or we're better than that, but we wind up becoming more critical and destructive to those that stray in a way that doesn't fit our standard.
Thank you. That's a really, I feel like the questions so far, I feel like they've really honored Roger in the sense of just the like depth and intensity of these two questions already. And so I just want to say I know he would appreciate that. So for me, you know, I think a lot about this question of kind of personal responsibility, right? Individual responsibility, and then institutions and structures, which is in a way what your question is about, I think. And if I get it wrong, then tell me. And I and you'll see lots of examples, this impulse of the twice as good to get half as far, right? You see that impulse represented throughout the book. I think that the mistake, and I also get the lecture. Like I get that the lecture is essential. Mm-hmm. Like I get it even more now that I'm a parent. I mean, I got it too because I was a teacher and teaching in a you know, overwhelmingly poor and African American environment, I would have these kinds of conversations with my students. But I really get it as a parent. Because my son, you know, he's 9 and he's just on the cusp of like have just being like really cute to being threatening. And I have that conversation with him a lot. That same conversation you're talking about. Here's the mistake that I think that we've made in black politics and that we absolutely have to rid ourselves of. It's about where is the conversation happening. In my opinion, the individual responsibility conversation is essential, and it should be reserved for the home. It should be reserved for the church. It should be reserved for the barbershop. Mm-hmm. It should be reserved for the hair salon. Those are all the places where it belongs and where it should be kept. Mm-hmm. It doesn't belong down in City Hall. Mm-hmm. It doesn't belong in the courtroom. Mm-hmm. See, in government, in policy, in politics, there, that conversation is not only irrelevant, but it's self-defeating in exactly the way you described. Mm-hmm. Because at City Hall, I don't want them talking about somebody has to be twice as good. That's offensive.
Yeah.
Because in government, you're supposed to be changing law and policy so that you don't have to be twice as good. Mm-hmm. It's racist that you would have to be twice as good. I mean, that's what that racism underlies that statement. Not the intent. Yeah. Right, but it's an acknowledgement of societal racism and constrained opportunity and limited options and unfair policing that underlie that statement. So if we're in the city council and we're talking about what laws to pass, there the only conversation we should be having is what can we do as a city, county, state, and nation so that nobody has to be twice as good to get half as far. Mm-hmm. So that everybody has opportunity, equal opportunity, including understanding and, when appropriate, reparations for past suffering. That's what the conversation that should be happening in halls of power. But this is I think that there's a whole generation of politicians, and it's still happening today, who are like lecturing their kids at home, and then they go to work. Mm-hmm. And they're like still, like the judge is like, save that lecture for your kid. Mm-hmm. But the lecture shouldn't be backed by sanction of law and punishment and Oak Hill, because here's the thing, and here's why. When you have the conversation on an individual level, it's always backed by one more chance. Mm-hmm. Like, you can say that all you want, but nobody's like, oh yeah, and he didn't do it, he wasn't twice as good, so let's call the police and lock him up. Mm-hmm. No parent says that. Mm-hmm. You're like, all right, you go, you know, you get together with your spouse or your family, loved ones, and you're like, well, the last talk didn't work. Mm-hmm. What else have we got up our sleeve? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
What if we repeat ourselves? Yeah. So that to me is the issue, is where is the place we're having the conversation? Both are essential, but both should be entirely separate domains. Mm.